As if going off to college isn't stressful enough, imagine throwing in a robot apocalypse. Well, that's the idea behind the new animated movie, The Mitchells versus the Machines, starring Abbi Jacobson as Katie. Watch.
I'm Katie. I'm sort of a weirdo. My parents haven't figured me out yet. To be fair, it took me a while to figure myself out.
Every family has its challenges.
We haven't had a good family picture in years because you two are always arguing.
For my family, our greatest challenge... probably the robot apocalypse.
First of all, welcome officially.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you here. How's life in general? How you doing?
Relatively speaking, I think I'm feeling okay at this point in the quarantine COVID experience. Staying home still, but yeah, I'm doing all right. How about you? Yeah,
good. You know, same. I'm okay, right? There's so much going on like, top of the pandemic. It's just like...
The world is terrible and... Yeah, it's sort of like one thing after the other. It's still every single day there's a horrific, there's something horrific. So yeah, I always try to say relatively, I'm like, I feel very lucky and fortunate, but it's quite the moment right now.
Right? Yeah, mm-hmm. crazy times. But something that is going to, I think, lift a lot of people's spirit, give them some hope, is the Mitchells versus the Machines. Let me tell you. So. This one is fun. Tell us a little bit, because I did an introduction and showed a clip, but just give us overall what this movie is about.
So I think this movie is really about finding your people at its core. Like if you're breaking it down, it's about really finding your people and realizing that yes, there's going to be all these new people in the world that you're going to go out and find and that will be so relatable. But really, when you think about it, if you're lucky, your family is you already have your people. Yeah. And it's a really important message. I think it's so that's at the core of it. But there's a lot more going on, which is there's sort of like an AI takeover of humanity by a phone, which is played by Olivia Colman brilliantly. And so these robots are sort of taking over humanity and technology is taking over. And this family, the Mitchells, which is the sort of the worst family to be in this role of saving the world.
The anti-heroes, right?
Yes, it's up to them to save the world because they're sort of the last family standing. So yeah, there's a lot going on, but I think there's so many like core things happening. It's really like the father-daughter relationship I just love. There's something in there for everybody.
I love it. And I love this kind of story with this family at the core at a time where, you know, with social media and everything, there's just so much about everybody wants to be perfect and everybody wants to, you know what I mean? Look a certain way, speak a certain way, behave, you know, we're all kind of following the latest trend and all that kind of stuff. And I love what this family represent at this time. Now you play Katie.
Uh-huh.
Tell us a little bit about your character.
Yeah, so Katie's about to go to college. She's this uber creative kid that cannot wait to go to film school. All she wants to do is be a filmmaker, and the way in which she uses her creativity is so refreshing to see in an animated film like this. She draws in her films, like she uses her brother and her dog in her films and her family in her films, and just uses every bit of technology, all the filters, every bit of technology to tell these stories that come out of her imagination. And she's just so excited to go to school. And I feel very lucky to get to play her. I really relate to her. I was very creative as a kid. I went to art school and I really felt like that was when I got to like expand my creative horizons, as they say. But she's just like a little bit of a weirdo in the best way possible and hasn't figured everything out about herself. Yeah, which I, again, really relate to even now. But she's queer and she's hilarious. And yeah, she's just a really rad, rad kid.
Yeah. Yeah. You mentioned going to art school, and I wanted to just, you know, cause you're an artist. I wonder when you first saw, I don't know how you first met Katie. Was it through sketches? Like, when did you first see this character and what'd you think of it? And did you get to weigh in at all? Like, I would change this or do that.
I didn't weigh in on it at all, but yeah, I remember I saw a still, like that. I saw an image of her and, you know, just down to like, so it was just her and her outfit and like the way in which she stands, which is like a little awkward, but she's just got such a style with the open sweatshirt and the pins, and like her nail polish is messed up and she's a little messy, but you can kind of see just in the image, that's the best when you see in the image exactly who this person is.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that's the first thing I saw. And then I started to see some movement. I mean, we've been animated movies take so long. This has been, I mean, years.
Wow. Years.
Yeah.
It's amazing that it takes them so long to get made, but when they come out, they seem so current, right?
Yes.
With the dialogue and everything. It's just, it's crazy how that happens.
I know. And I guess, I mean, I'm not an animator, but I think maybe they can go in and like update stuff to make it like even more current. Yeah, but this film, the animation style is so unique. I wish I should have like asked the terminology of what exactly differentiates this style from previous styles, but it just feels very different and fresh and almost like there's a lot of different animation styles used on top of each other, especially when... So they do this incredible thing when we go into what they've been calling Katie vision, which is like her, the like how she's experiencing the moment at hand, which is sort of like you see how she feels sort of enacted. And it's like, yeah, it's Katie vision. And it's just so cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I was going to ask you, you know, you see the sketch and, you know, you read the script, and as an actress, how do you bring that to life, you know, where you're saying something, but you don't know what the, you know, you're not able to use your hands to express it, you know, that I think comes later. I don't know. Like, and so I, you know, what you're talking about with Katie vision, that must be very helpful to embodying this character and bringing her to life.
Yeah. The recording process on this, I mean, in any animated thing is so different than a live action thing because yeah, I'm using my whole body when I am doing the voiceover, but you know that the voice is the only thing that's going to be pulled for the performance, you know? So yeah. In the recording booth, it's funny, they have this like bar right in front of the mic for me. So I'm always like really gripping the bar because it helps me to, I don't know what it is. It helps ground me. And because sometimes I will tend to perform with my whole body, but it's sort of trying my best to filter it just through my voice is this very different experience than being live action, if that makes sense. Yeah. But yeah, and it's also not done all at once. You kind of come in for sections. You record in sections. Sorry, my dog just came back in. you record in sections, so it's such a different experience, but then you also get to like re-record and revisit scenes as the animation cycle progresses throughout the years in which it's being made. And so you get to revisit scenes and sort of look at it with the animation on a screen. And then I'm like, oh, I see what the animators did with her body.
Yeah.
And I want to truly embody that with my voice. Yeah, it's kind of a fascinating experience.
It really, really is. I mean, wow, that really is pretty, pretty fascinating. So let's talk about this cast. You mentioned Olivia Colman, Maya Rudolph, Danny McBride, Eric Andre, John Legend.
I know
you're going to say, Abbi, that you all never saw each other. You were in different, like, was there any moment that you all got together, or at least you got together with some of them?
It's really upsetting the way in which these are done because it's like, this is the cast of my dreams.
Right? And
every once in a while on animated projects, they'll try to get everyone in a room, especially with a cast like this, because so many of us are improvisers. So like, you know, it just like, and doing a scene with your scene partner just always helps you. It comes out better that way. But so much of this, I mean, we were probably doing it for a year and a half before COVID, but then COVID happened and I was in the studio. Mike Rianda, who is the director and who plays my little brother, was in there with me. So he would often read with me, but during COVID he was on a Zoom.
Yeah.
And so no, we never got together. I mean, I know a bunch of them,
yeah,
but we never got to record together. I've never even met Danny, who plays
my wow.
Yeah.
That's so crazy.
I know. I feel like that's a terrible reality to say in press. It's so upsetting. It's like, you guys have never even met?
Yeah, but it just speaks to what the process is like. I mean, I think it still adds to how fascinating it all comes together, because when you see it, you know what I mean? You would never know that, right?
Right.
But you, it's so funny because I'm thinking, well, at least, you know, during the press tour, we'll get to see each other.
I know. COVID so fun. Eric Andre and I also do an animated show together called Disenchantment. And so we have recorded together so much. And it's so funny. We're like always in the same animated stuff together. So we're always like, you're in this too. And we were talking about how fun the press tour was going to be. And then no, next time,
yeah. Part two.
Yeah. Let's do, they need to save the world again.
Yes. Come on. Technology is here to stay.
I know.
There could be more from this family. Speaking of technology, did experiencing this movie and just the story of it all, right? Not that we haven't seen a situation where AI has taken over before, but just experiencing this yourself, did it make you look at Siri in a different way or put your phone down, maybe not use it as much?
Yeah, so I never use Siri.
Really?
I'm pretty bad at technology, yeah. I mean, I'm on my computer all the time because I write on it and I'm Zooming constantly now. And I my phone is like, right. I have all the stuff, but I try not to, I am really attempting to not be on it as much as I can because I work on it all day long, especially the social media stuff. I mean, I know that's not really exactly what this film is talking about, but for me, the social media stuff has been the biggest like puzzle piece, because it is so helpful in so many ways. It helps me know more about what's going on and community wise and like activism and just be more engaged. But also it's this cycle of, it's so addictive. It's so a part of like my daily cycle that I need to, I watched this doc called The Social Dilemma that really hit me hard. And I'm trying to limit it. But I related to both Rick, who plays my dad, and Katie in the sense that Rick was like, can we just live life and not constantly be on a phone and filming it? And because I feel that way, I'm like, put down your phone and be in nature instead of constantly like taking a photo of it. And then I also really relate to Katie in that it is, I mean, I did Broad City, which was the biggest thing I've done so far. We started on YouTube. I'm like, I'm so tied to it that I really understand the tools it provides, but I'm also probably closer to Rick's age now. And I'm like, can we just experience life? Like I remember the world without the internet. And
Right. Yeah. That's so true. Okay. We got to talk about A League of Their Own.
I was like, okay, what are we getting into?
How excited are you to be a part of this? You're writing, producing, and starring in this. What can you tell us for those of us who are just like, love the movie, over the moon that this is happening? How will it be different from the movie?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for saying that, because there's a lot of pressure. This is people's favorite movie.
Girl.
It, I know what I'm up against here. And I will reassure everyone that this isn't, the movie still exists. This show is a totally different take on the movie. So the league was real. This really happened. And it's almost like Penny Marshall saw a documentary about the league and made the movie. And it's like, we saw the documentary and guess what? We're going to make it different. And so there's none of the same characters. It is the same league, but we're really talking more about women in the time that wanted to play baseball. And that includes women that were so lucky, were lucky enough to get into the league, the All-American Girls League. But also there's a moment in the movie that's now when you look at, or then too, there's like a foul ball and a Black woman picks it up and throws it back to Gina Davis. And she's like, ow, and to sort of show like how hard she threw it. And then nothing about that, because you're watching now and I'm like, what is this? And Black women were not allowed to even try out for the league.
Yeah.
And any other woman of color that was actually in the league, there was a lot of Cuban women, a lot of Mexican American women, or not a lot, a couple, they sort of had to be white passing in the time to be in the league. And so our show is really showing what happens when the door opens for some women and they get on the league, and what happens when the door doesn't open, and where do they go and play baseball? And it's sort of, I'm telling you so much about it because I'm in the middle of it right now.
Don't stop.
It's sort of split between these two worlds. My character Carson is in the league, and Max, who's played by Shantae Adams, who's brilliant, a legit movie star. Max is not allowed to try out, and ends up being. She's based on a number of women that ended up playing in the Negro Leagues with men. Which is this like, no one knows about these stories. There was a Broadway show.
I saw it.
Oh, then you know. So she's roughly based on a number of women that is a whole other part of women playing baseball that's never really been told.
Yeah.
And so, yes, you're going to see a lot of nods to the movie. You're going to see a lot of nods to the Peaches and some nods to specific characters, but it's really a two-hander that's hinging back and forth between these two women and these two worlds in which someone gets the door open and someone gets the door shut in their face, and how they still go and get to live their dream. And it's just been, we're in prep mode right now. So we're about to shoot it. The scripts are pretty much almost there. And I feel really good about it. So I missed the whole part. It's also an extremely queer story. Believe it or not, it's like a insane, believe it or not, some of the women that played professional baseball were queer, and that was not a thing that was told in the film at all. So we're really trying to sort of amplify a lot of the real stories that of women playing baseball of the time, and so much of it is about right now too, unfortunately. So there's a lot going on. The ensemble is absolutely incredible. The cast, I can't believe how lucky I am that we got all these incredible people to be on the show. I think and hope that you like it. It's funny. It's really dramatic, and there's a lot of baseball. I think it's going to be good.
It sounds like it. I mean, I'm so glad I asked you this and you went into such great detail, because you just painted this picture for me that sounds so fascinating and feels very different from the movie, like completely different. I'm excited about this. When do you feel like, I know pandemic and everything, when do you feel like we'll get a release date? Like, when do you think it'll end up coming?
I haven't gotten a release date, but I think it will be probably end of this year, early next year. Because we haven't even shot it yet, so.
Yeah. Now, even though it's very different from the film, I hear that you got the blessing of Gina Davis and the late Penny Marshall. Is that true?
Yeah, we were lucky enough. We spoke to Gina about it, and we were lucky enough to get on a call with Penny Marshall before she passed away, which was just I mean, just unbelievable. Yeah. And we've spoken to Rosie.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's been really great. And also just, we wanted to reassure them that, you know, I'm not playing Dottie. I don't think I'm ever going to be trying to play Gina Davis. It's just, we were very different women, you know, but, yeah. I mean, I hope that they're excited about it, but yeah, we got an opportunity to talk to all of them, which was great.
I love that. Well, I want to let everybody know you can catch The Mitchells versus The Machines streaming on Netflix right now. Abbi, thank you so much for making
time. Thank you so much. This has been such a pleasure. Yeah, this made my day.
Yeah, me too. This is good stuff.
All right.
All right. Good luck on everything. I can't wait.
Thanks.
To see it all. All right. Be well.
So nice to meet you.
Yeah, you too.
Have a good one. Okay. Stay safe.
I will. You too.
All right. Bye.
Okay.